Hello, I'm Michael Tsarion. In my article entitled The Constitution Con, I emphasized that the United States has always been a colony of Britain, or more correctly, a vassal state owned and controlled by the British Crown. In the article, I wrote of the devious and elaborate ruses employed by the royal families of Britain and Europe to ensure that Americans would believe themselves free and sovereign when in fact they are anything but. I named the names and described how various court-appointed lieutenants, such as Benjamin Franklin, Roger Livingstone, James Madison, Alexander Hamilton, Robert Morris, Nicholas Biddle, Gouvernier Morris, and many others set about undermining the freedom of Americans. They and their ideological descendants have succeeded in bringing ruin to the Americas. The presidents of recent history have been little more than their political offspring, continuing the nefarious machinations set into motion by King George III and the chief executive officers of the British Crown Corporation. This knowledge concerning the Constitution Con has been researched and broadcast by several men. Their works on the subject are listed at the bottom of my article, which can be found by going to the Michael Tsarion website and clicking on the next button. Among the greatest researchers to expose the connections between the political figures of America and the British royals are Eustace Mullins, G. Edward Griffin, Dr. John Coleman, Anthony Sutton, Webster Tarpley, Jeffrey Steinberg, Lyndon LaRouche, and Ralph Epperson. Their works are highly recommended. It's important that their superlative works are distributed widely and placed in libraries and public locations so that the great deception that has brought America low can be exposed before all Americans who, despite their ignorance and apathy, deserve to know the truth. The relevant references within the work of the great researchers, which expertly exposes the British oligarchical control of America, must be disseminated over the internet for the same purpose. I myself will be working to make the works of these and other perceptive men available by way of my sites and forums. I've often publicly stated that astrologically speaking, we now occupy an age of awakening and revealing. I've predicted that we will, in this time, find out the truth concerning our origins and destiny. And I've also predicted that all manner of other lies will be exposed. Indeed, as every week goes by, new light is thrown on old mysteries and conundrums. This very month, new evidence concerning the Declaration of Independence has come to light. The Declaration of Independence officially came into being on August the 2nd, 1776, 11 years before the signing of the U.S. Constitution on September 17th, 1787. In June of 1775, a group calling themselves the Continental Congress met in Philadelphia at Carpenter's Hall in order to establish a committee to draft the Declaration. Most of the men in the Congress were high-degree Freemasons. This included Thomas Jefferson, who, due to his prodigious intellect and erudition, was chosen to draft the Declaration. Then, on the famous date of July 4th, 1776, America's official birthday, a second Continental Congress met at the Pennsylvania State House, later to be known as Independence Hall, to approve Jefferson's work. That day, John Hancock signed the Declaration, whereas the other delegates, 55 of them, would sign it later, on August the 2nd, 1776. The reason for the delay between July and August has to do with astrological timing. As we said, many of the delegates were Masons, and they knew that July is the period of the dog days and the rising of the Nile River in Egypt. It is also when the all-important star Sirius rises into view. This star is sacred to the goddess Isis, who is also known as Ishtar, Ashtarte, Asherah, and Ashtoreth. July is the month astrologically associated with the sign of Cancer, the sign under which America was born. Cancer is known as the gate of souls and has long been associated with birth and new life. The chariot card of the tarot, card number 7, is the card that esoterically signifies the sign of Cancer. However, in esoteric traditions and in Masonry, the sign of Virgo, the Virgin, is vitally important for many reasons. One reason why Virgo is significant is because it was the sign that opened the Egyptian calendar. In other words, when the sun entered into the sign of the female or virgin, the Egyptian New Year began. One of the most important, as well as one of the brightest stars in the heavens, is known as Spike. In fact, this is a word that is employed quite frequently by advertisers and corporations. But on star maps, Spike is seen above the staff or stalk of wheat held by the celestial virgin. We cannot explore the symbolism of this star further in this presentation. We can only emphasize that Spike played a significant role for the Masons who drafted, signed, and delivered the Declaration of Independence. And we might note that the U.S. Constitution was also brought before the people on September 17th, 1787. That is, in the sign of Virgo. But what is so suspicious about the Declaration of Independence, I hear you ask? In short, the recent dilemma concerns a single word written by the document's author, Thomas Jefferson. And that word is citizens. Not that there's anything untoward about that term. It's what has been discovered behind it. That's right, this word was apparently written over another word that has now, with the latest hyperspectral photographic technology, been discerned. And that word is subjects. No big deal, some of you might be saying. Well, I hope you're not saying that, because the difference between these two words is, in fact, a very big deal. And that the word subjects was written into the Declaration by Thomas Jefferson himself is also a very big deal. But you retort, the mistake he made was corrected. It happened accidentally, when he wasn't thinking. Well, that can certainly be the answer to the problem. If you're the kind of person who believes that Thomas Jefferson would be the kind of man to make a spelling mistake on a much-previewed declaration, and then have to ask his mates for an eraser to scrub out his poor choice of words. If you are that kind of person, the person to fall for such an obviously ridiculous cover story, then I can certainly recommend a great vacation package next time you're in the mood for an exciting holiday. Of course, now that the controversy has hit the headlines, the media laughs it off as a mistake. But let's pause again for a moment and think about the reports that have come across the ubiquitous media oracles. What is going on here, we might ask. We must open our eyes and ears and get the subtextual significance of what has happened. The news about the Declaration's strange wording is coming to the world now, at this important point. Coincidentally, exactly at the same time that America took birth, the month of July. For ritualistic purposes, that is what you must get your mind around. We are meant to know that this word subjects is there. As Ralph Epperson rightly states in his video entitled America's Secret Destiny, we are meant to know that we've made ourselves into willing slaves or serfs, and that we have voluntarily divested ourselves of our rights. This travesty occurred because, as I pointed out elsewhere, documents such as the Declaration and Constitution make use of talismanic words. These documents are talismanic documents, designed to enthrall us so that we voluntarily offer ourselves as subjects of the crown. This is precisely what Americans have been duped into doing. We've not been forced into slavery, but wooed into it. We've accepted salt for sugar, merely because they look alike. Is it any wonder the cuisine tastes rotten? Moreover, the so-called mistake did not happen because old Uncle Tommy lost his concentration while peering out the window at some passing bit of skirt. No, he wrote one word in, purposely erased it, and then deliberately overwrote it with the new deceptive word. It was an exercise in ritualistic duplicity. But we may ask, why did he do such a bizarre thing? Why go to this kind of trouble? Well, it's the same kind of trouble that his masters and predecessors have gone to throughout the ages. In this one incident, we get to see the whole game. Because we're meant to see the man and the straw man behind it. We're meant to see and know what's going on in the world. The wars, conquests, rivalries, famines, upheavals, outbreaks of disease, ecocide, mass paranoia, and so on. We are meant to see it, and then we're meant to edit out the parts we don't care to see that cause us pain or which threaten our overall ideas about reality. Legally speaking and ritually speaking, the controllers play games with our minds. They know that we're under their control. They want us to know it too. And they also know when to conceal their power and tone down their machinations. They know how to enthrall and mesmerize us with talismanic words and phrases, with promises of this and that kind of utopia. They know how to dazzle and beguile us, and how to keep us exactly where they want us, in their great hierarchical bastille. The two antithetical words were blended together on purpose.